Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us. It's a pleasure to welcome you today to a special panel presentation, Educating a New Nation, James Bowdoin III and the Pioneering Art Collecting and the Pioneering of Art Collecting in the Early American Republic. The subject is particularly near and dear to our hearts because it sheds light on the origin of our very own institution. My own connection to the museum is relatively recent. My husband, Frank, and I had the pleasure of joining the Bowdoin College Museum of Art just a little over 2 years ago, and we are delighted that we are delighted to be a part of this community and thrilled by the wonderful membership the museum has. For those of you who have not yet had an opportunity to join the museum, I think you will have ample reason to do so. At the conclusion of today's program, we have wonderful cards as well as calendars recording our various offerings that are available when you exit the auditorium. Membership, of course, is free, but gives us an opportunity to stay in touch with all of you about everything going on at the museum. The more I learn about James Bowdoin III, the more I realize that he's a man very much after our own heart. Or perhaps I should say that we seem to be following in the spirit he set out when he founded the college, Bowdoin College, in 1794. Not only did James Bowdoin III understand the value of cultivating and educating young citizens of the American Republic, but he also recognized that art would be a critical ingredient in this initiative. One of the very first collectors of fine arts in the United States, James Bowdoin III brought together work by the old masters of Europe with that of his own American contemporaries. Not only did Bowdoin give the college he endowed what would become the first public collection of drawings in the United States, but he demonstrated through this gift that it would comprise a central role in educating new members of the American Republic. Today, his pioneering activities will be addressed by three experts in the field: Ellen Miles, curator emerita of paintings and sculpture at the National Portrait Gallery of the Smithsonian Institution; Richard Saunders, director of the Middlebury College Museum of Art; and Sarah Cantor, summer 2015 Samuel H. Kress Research Fellow at the Bowdoin College Museum of Art. I would like to offer a brief introduction for each of our speakers prior to their 20-minute presentation. At the conclusion of the third talk, which will be delivered by Sarah, we will have an opportunity for discussion with the audience, and we very much look forward to hearing your thoughts. It is now my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, Ellen Miles. Ellen Miles is the curator emerita in the Department of Painting and Sculpture at the National Portrait Gallery. A graduate of Bryn Mawr College and Yale University, Miles joined the NPG staff in 1971. Since then, she has created numerous important and always meticulously researched exhibitions, books, and articles with a focus on 18th and 19th century American and British portraiture. Ellen, among other things, is a leading scholar on the work of Gilbert Stuart and helped to organize the major exhibition of his work with Carrie Rebora Barrett in 2004 and 2005, seen at the Metropolitan Museum of Art and the National Gallery in Washington, D.C. It is a special pleasure to welcome Ellen, who also played a major role in introducing my husband and myself to the pleasures of curating American portraiture. Ellen, thank you very much for being with us.
Uh, it's a delight to be here, to talk about Stuart and to be here with the Goodyears. I'm great fans of theirs. You can hear everything, okay, good. Even in this short talk, you will see how incomplete the record of Stuart's work is. Stuart, who is endlessly fascinating to many of us, left no collection of diaries, checklists, or other manuscripts or letters. And so we historians are dependent on the observations of his contemporaries. These comments and the portraits themselves are the primary evidence of his career. And we find much of the documentation when researching the paintings and the individuals that he painted. Now, there's an alert for this talk. I hope that you know the names of the first five presidents and the order of their presidencies. There'll be a quiz at the end. Let's see. You know these paintings, I'm sure. James Bowdoin's commission of these portraits of James Madison and Thomas Jefferson is highly significant for three reasons. First, Bowdoin's commission guaranteed, I believe, that Stuart would paint a portrait of Jefferson from life in 1805. That life portrait is the source for Stuart's additional portraits of Jefferson, including this one. And I'll come back to that point. Second, Bowdoin's contact with Stuart led to numerous commissions for portraits of himself and members of his family, including his wife Sarah and his sister Elizabeth Bowdoin, who was Lady Temple, and her family. And third, because the portraits of Jefferson and Madison were here at Bowdoin, Stuart was able to come and copy his own portrait of Madison to complete two very important series of portraits of the first five presidents. So, how did this all come about? President Thomas Jefferson appointed James Bowdoin as minister to the court of Spain in November 1804. On March 25, 1805, before his departure that May, Bowdoin wrote to his friend General Henry Dearborn, Jefferson's Secretary of War, in Washington, now Bowdoin in Boston. "I shall be much obliged to you to procure me the portraits of Mr. Jefferson and Mr. Madison if a good painter can be found at Washington, and if they would be willing to take the trouble to sit for them. I should be glad to have them sent to one of the Atlantic ports of Spain, subject to my order. Mr. Winthrop, who is his nephew by marriage, will pay your draft on presentment for the amount of the painter's bill. I should like to have them done by Stuart, if could he be induced to execute them as well as he is able. They need not be framed, as I can procure more fashionable and better frames in Europe. Please to let ye pictures be half length and of a size to match each other." And these are the sum total of the directions that we have about the commission and the imagery and the format of the two paintings. For the portrait of James Madison, Stuart relied on the smaller portrait that he had painted the previous year, which was a commission from the Madisons as a pendant with the portrait of Dolly Madison. But he needed to paint an entirely new portrait of Jefferson. He had painted the portrait of President Jefferson in Philadelphia in 1800, at Jefferson's request, but it was never completed or delivered and does not survive. And this engraving, which was long thought to be evidence of that portrait, is now considered a copy of a portrait by another artist, and that the attribution to Stuart is incorrect. About Stuart, Jefferson wrote many years later that it was in May 1800 I got him to draw my picture, and immediately after that last sitting I paid him his price, $100. When he came to Washington in 1805, he told me he was not satisfied with it and therefore begged me to sit again. And he drew another, which he was to deliver to me instead of the first, but begged permission to keep it until he could get an engraving of it. And I'll come back to this, but you'd be interested to know that actually Jefferson didn't get his portrait by Stuart until 1821. The probable result of this 1805 sitting was a now unlocated life study of Jefferson's face and head, the rest of the painting left unfinished. This canvas was described by Henry Pickering in 1817, a visitor to Stuart's studio, as a head of Mr. Jefferson executed in one sitting, a fine likeness, intended to be a three quarters. The existence of such a life study explained Stuart's comment on seeing these two portraits, or his two portraits here, of Jefferson and Madison in 1821. His remark was recorded by Alpheus Spring Packard, a member of the faculty. Quote, "Stuart declared in 1821 that he regarded them as good as originals." Henry Pickering also asked the artist to explain the terminology of sizes. And he made this sketch to help remember. Stuart's largest portraits were full lengths. Now, I'm not sure if there's a pointer, but that's all right. Stuart's largest paintings were full lengths, and you can see on the lower right a diagram of a full-length portrait. And on that canvas in the center, the full length would have been the whole canvas, turned vertically. The next smaller size was half length, because the canvases were made by cutting a full length in half. And on these, the artist would paint a figure to the knees. So the terminology is opposite of what we would expect. A half-length portrait shows a portrait the way you see Mr. Jefferson's portrait. The next smaller size was called a three-quarter, because apparently its size, 30 by 25, resulted from cutting down a half-length. And with each reduction in size, Stuart painted less detail around the figure, so that the viewer would concentrate on the person in the portrait. As Stuart told his pupil, Matthew Harris Jewett, quote, "Backgrounds should contain whatever is necessary to illustrate the character of the person. The eye should see the application of the parts to the illustration of the whole, but without separating or attracting the attention from the main point. Backgrounds point to dates and circumstances peculiarly of employment or profession, but the persons should be so portrayed as to be read like a Bible without notes, which in books are likened unto backgrounds in paintings." And now this is my favorite quote about Stuart. "Too much parade in the background, like notes with a book to it, are very apt to fatigue by the constant shifting of attention." And I think this explains why the larger the portrait by Stuart, the more there is in the background. And you'll see in the exhibition and the portraits of the Bowdoin family that the head and shoulders size portrait has almost usually no background at all. The two paintings were not completed in time for Bowdoin's departure for Spain in April 1805. Henry Dearborn reported to Thomas Winthrop, who was the husband of Bowdoin's niece, Elizabeth Winthrop, that Mr. Stuart has nearly completed them and will take them with his other effects to Boston, and when completed will deliver them to you to be forwarded to Mr. Bowdoin. Stuart was also on the move, persuaded to settle in Boston by Senator Jonathan Mason of Massachusetts, who promised commissions from his family and friends and, quote, "an introduction to the entire town." Stuart arrived in Boston sometime in July 1805. The completed paintings of Madison and Jefferson, however, were never sent to Bowdoin in Europe. Because of illness, Bowdoin went first to London to recuperate, then to Paris to await word that he would be received in Madrid. Instead, he served his entire posting in Paris. Resigning in 1807, he returned home to Boston in April 1808, and Stuart delivered the portraits after his return. For Stuart, the move to Boston was almost like coming home. He had many connections with sitters whose portraits he had painted in Philadelphia, including John and Abigail Adams, Sarah Apthorpe Morton, an Englishman named John Richards, who was the agent for the London banking firm of Francis and John Baring, and Stuart's friendships with members of the Vaughan family, which also dated from his years in England. Now we turn to the family portraits. Here, the comments by sitters provide the documentation. James Bowdoin's sister, Elizabeth Bowdoin, on the right, Lady Temple, commissioned most of these, and they are well documented in letters. Her daughter, Eliza Winthrop, first mentioned her mother's portrait when writing to her aunt, Sarah Bowdoin, in Paris in November 1806. "Stuart has just finished her picture, which is an excellent likeness. He is also copying my father's, and my mother gives them to me to take the place of those done by Copley. I have sat three times for mine, as my mother is determined to have all her children taken by him." She mentions a portrait of her father, Sir John Temple. Sir John Temple had died in 1798, and Stuart had been commissioned to copy the portrait of him that was painted by John Trumbull in 1784, and you see that one on the left. Trumbull's portrait was, as we said, a half length, or 50 by 40. So Stuart painted a pendant of Lady Temple on the right to match this large format. And these were given to their daughter, Augusta Temple Palmer. The portrait of Lady Temple is unlocated, but I thought you'd be interested in seeing that. Eliza Winthrop was given a smaller pair, measuring about 30 by 25 each, as she wrote her aunt, "Stuart has finished my father's and mother's pictures, and they are very excellent. Do persuade my uncle to have his done, like the ones of yours and Sarah's, and give it to me. I have the one done by Lovett, hanging alongside of yours, but it's not a good likeness. Do tell him that it would be gratifying both to me and my husband if he would sit for his portrait." Sarah Bowdoin's portrait had been painted in Paris by an artist named Henri Van Gorp, who I know very little, nothing about, but no portrait of James Bowdoin has survived by this artist, if indeed one was ever painted. So you can see that James Bowdoin is not as quick to sit for his portrait. So here we have the portraits of James Bowdoin and Sarah Bowdoin by Gilbert Stuart. The documentation for these portraits is less complete and a bit puzzling. The portrait of Sarah Bowdoin is first mentioned in a letter that Eliza Winthrop wrote 3 days after the letter about her mother's portraits. Eliza wrote that she asked Stuart if he could alter the drapery of the one which he took of you, which he can with much ease when you return. This, of course, means that Stuart had begun Sarah's portrait in Boston. But if we assume that Sarah sailed with her husband to Spain in the spring of 1805, when and where did she sit for Stuart, who did not arrive in Boston till that summer? There's no evidence that she or her husband had traveled to Philadelphia or Washington, where Stuart could have painted their portraits. One possibility is that perhaps she didn't leave Boston until after Stuart arrived and was able to sit for her portrait in 1805 or 1806. Of her travels to Europe, I only so far know that she kept a diary in Paris, which she began on October 1st, 1806. So that's one of the many mysteries. The portrait of James Bowdoin is even more difficult to document. First of all, we have no references at all to prove that Bowdoin and Stuart ever met. The letters for the commission of the two larger portraits of Jefferson and Madison provide no evidence of a meeting. Later, when Eliza Winthrop was sitting for her own portrait, she wrote that Stuart, quote, is a very pleasant companion and promises himself much pleasure in conversing with my uncle when he returns. This statement confirms nothing except that Stuart and Eliza talked about James Bowdoin. And in July 1807, Bowdoin in Paris wrote Thomas Winthrop that he had purchased some painting materials for Stuart. And here you see the palette, which is in the exhibition on the left, and on the right, sketch, a detailed sketch of the colors of Stuart's palette by Nathaniel Josselyn, who visited him in 1823. We have several of these sketches by different artists who were so admiring of Stuart's palette that they copied the colors and the purposes of the colors. Bowdoin wrote to Winthrop, I have purchased a number of pencils, which are brushes, agreeably to Mr. Stuart's request, which I shall forward by the first opportunity. And I've added an assortment of impalpable colors, which I understand are equally good and much more economical than colors ground in oil. And we've looked that up, and it seems to mean that they're powdered colors that are not mixed with oil, because impalpable means that they're so fine in the grinding that when rubbed between the fingers, there's no grit in them. And then, of course, they would send them to Stuart, and then Stuart could add the oil that he needed to paint. So he writes, in this case, Mr. Stuart will put ye oil to ye colors as he wants them. They have been carefully selected by a painter and procured at the lowest prices. Their cost is 258 livres. But the request for these pigments most likely had come to him from Winthrop, not directly from Stuart. The only documentation that Stuart painted Bowdoin's portrait is this engraving on the right, that was published with Bowdoin's obituary in Polyanthos, a Boston periodical, in July 1812. The inscription, which is hard to see, but it's right below the engraving, on the right is the engraving, reads G. Stuart Pinks, P-I-N-X, which means in Latin, painted it, and J.R. Smith Sculpt, which means J.R. Smith engraved it. And this is a very common engraving tool, a engraving attribution. I agree with Marvin Sadek and Richard Saunders, who concluded that the best explanation is that the painting is a copy of the miniature of Bowdoin that Edward Green Malbone had painted in 1804, and you see that on the left and in the exhibition. One telling clue is that the painting of Bowdoin is set in a painted oval, which you can't see in the slide, but you can see that in the painting, which reflects the shape of the miniature. This is a format that Stuart rarely used. It also seems very likely that the painting was done after Bowdoin had died as a memorial image. Now we turn to Stuart's visit to Bowdoin College in 1821. And again, we have very few comments about the trip, and they primarily concern specific portraits. We do know that the visit here enabled Stuart to complete two series of portraits of the first five presidents, which are known today by the men who commissioned them. This is the Gibbs series. It was painted for Stuart's longtime friend, George Gibbs. Years later, in 1853, a close friend of Stuart's wrote this comment. about the series, which suggests that perhaps Gibbs was the originator of the idea of a series of five president portraits. Colonel Gibbs was so desirous of having his set complete that he employed Stuart at considerable expense to visit Bowdoin College and make a copy of President, and he makes a mistake and says Monroe, but he means Madison, of President Madison that he painted for that institution. So the next series was painted for Boston art dealer and frame maker John Doggett, who exhibited them in Boston in 1822, and also arranged to have lithographs made of them. The French technique of lithography had only recently been introduced in the United States, and Doggett's attempts to have lithographs made in Boston failed. Finally, the portraits were lithographed in France. Sad to say, the Doggett series of paintings is now incomplete. Three of the five portraits, those of Washington, Adams, and Jefferson, were destroyed in a fire in the Library of Congress in 1851. So for this discussion, I will use the lithographs to replace the missing portraits in the Doggett series. For the portraits of Washington, we can tell from the Gibbs copy in the center and the lithograph on the right that Stuart copied his own unfinished life portrait of the first president, which he had painted in 1796 and which is now known as the Athenaeum portrait. He still owned the original and already had made dozens of copies for other patrons. For the portrait of Adams, whom he had first painted in Philadelphia in 1800, and you can see that portrait is on the left, Stuart visited Adams at home in Quincy, Massachusetts in September 1821 for a new sitting of 2 to 3 hours. In the middle is the Gibbs series portrait, and on the right is the lithograph, which interestingly enough is the only one in the group that reverses the portrait. And I don't know why, but it does. John Quincy Adams noted in his diary, Stuart paints this picture for a Mr. Doggett as one of the five presidents of the United States. He is to paint all for him. This lithograph, as I said, appears to be the only one that's in reverse. For the portrait of Thomas Jefferson, Stuart copied the life study that he had painted in 1805, which he owned. And as I said, that late life portrait, if it's the one from the 1828 exhibition, where it was described as Thomas Jefferson, the original head, painted for Mr. Jefferson, quite honestly, we don't have that painting now. We don't know where that painting is. But what you see here is the copies from that original. On the left, the portrait that we call the Edge Hill portrait, which was the one that was finally sent to Jefferson in 1821 to resolve the commission of 1805, when Jefferson said he sat to him again in 1805. It took that long for finally the Dearborn family members to get Stuart to finally send Jefferson the picture. And then for the portrait of Monroe, for Doggett's series, Stuart borrowed a portrait from George Gibbs on the left that he had painted in 1817. He had written Gibbs in May 1820, and I think this is why Gibbs wanted the series. He had the portrait of Monroe, and he wanted the other four portraits to complete the series. So it worked well with the Doggett's plan to have a series of presidents from Stuart also. So Stuart had written Gibbs in May 1821, permit me to remind you of the obliging promise you were so good to make me when I last had the pleasure of seeing you, of the head of Mr. Monroe. Mr. Doggett is now in New York and will take charge of it, which would be the most safe and convenient mode of conveyance that could be advised. So here, finally, we have the Gibbs series portrait, the surviving James Monroe portrait in the center, and then the lithograph after the James Monroe Doggett portrait on the right-hand side. As you know, however, Stuart did not have available a portrait of Madison that he could copy, and that's why he came to Bowdoin College in 1821. This comparison shows how Stuart began with the portrait here, reduced the format slightly to fit the Doggett series, which is slightly smaller, and then you can see that the lithograph is very faithful to the Doggett painting in the center. It shows how closely the lithographs reproduce them. And here I'm showing you an unusual painting on the right. This was a replica of the Doggett Washington, which, as I said, is lost. It was painted in 1822 for American merchant William David Lewis, and just recently it made the headlines because it was purchased from New York Hammer Galleries for the Louvre Museum in Abu Dhabi, so it is now in Abu Dhabi. But it does seem to be exactly like the missing Doggett painting. You can see from the lithograph how well they line up. So as far as the imagery in these portraits is concerned, I know of only one comment written by John Doggett Jr. in 1837. In the picture of Washington, which I heard Stuart pronounce to my father as the best portrait he ever had painted of that illustrious man, a sheathed sword, so a sword that's in the sheath, and a rainbow in the background are represented as signifying that war and strife have ceased and the storms of the revolution passed away. In each of the pictures, tassels are introduced appended to the draperies. They were intended to illustrate the number of terms that each served. If Gibbs was perhaps the initiator of the idea of the series, John Doggett certainly made the most of his commission. He exhibited the five presidential portraits in Boston in 1822 and again in 1824 for the triumphal return visit of the Marquis de Lafayette. They were also included in the memorial exhibition after Stuart's death in 1828, where they were described as the only uniform series of the presidents in existence, painted expressly for the Messrs. Doggett. For the imagery in Doggett's painting of Jefferson, there is a nagging question. If the lithograph accurately replicates the painting that was lost in the fire in 1851, the original painting presumably included a bust of Franklin, copied from this portrait by Jean-Jacques Caffieri. Now, the Vaughan family in Maine did own an example of this sculpture. This one actually is from Philadelphia, from the Philosophical Society. And that sculpture is now in the Bowdoin College collection, and it's in the exhibition, so you can compare the two. But what we don't know, I don't think any, maybe someone in the audience will know, why was this imagery added to the portrait of Jefferson? I don't have an answer. And I leave you with this mystery, and I hope lots of questions. Thank you very much.
We can maybe take the next set of slides as we transition to, oh, I see. Caroline will help me with that. Oh, no, that's perfect. Well, as Caroline works on our next set of slides, it's my pleasure to introduce our second speaker, Richard Saunders. Richard Saunders is the director of the Middlebury College Museum of Art and has been at Middlebury since 1985. But we might fairly say that Rick, as a graduate of Bowdoin College, was himself a direct beneficiary of James Bowdoin III's collecting. Indeed, as a highly regarded scholar and curator of American art, Rick did pioneering work on Bowdoin's collection for the important 1994 study edited by Catherine Watson, The Legacy of James Bowdoin III. At Yale, where he received his PhD, Rick did groundbreaking research on John Smibert, which became the basis for a major monograph on the artist. Rick is the author of the forthcoming book, American Faces, A Cultural History of Portraiture and Identity. We very much look forward to seeing it when it appears next year, together with the accompanying exhibition at Middlebury College. And now we look forward to hearing more from Rick about Smibert's connection to Bowdoin and his collections. Thank you, Rick, for being with us, and please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you, Anne, for those very generous words. It's always great to come back to Bowdoin. It brings back a lot of positive memories. Well, what I want to talk to you about today is really a little bit like what Ellen said, that there are more questions than answers. We're really looking for answers to this interesting relationship. And it's been a puzzle for some time about how did James Bowdoin III acquire so many of the works that have become central to our study of the beginnings of the Bowdoin College collection. In 1811, James Bowdoin III died on Nauchon Island, one of the Elizabeth Islands off the coast of Cape Cod, and is said to have died in this armchair, which still sits in the upper bedroom of the house on Noshan Island. Bowdoin was particularly enamored with Noshan and spent some of his happiest days of his latter years of his life here, focused on agricultural pursuits in particular, and living in what is now called the mansion house, which he built. The setting really is as spectacular today as it must have been during Bowdoin's residency, and as Ellen and I were talking earlier this day, I think one of the first orders of business for Anne and Frank is to pay a visit to Noshan Island. When Bowdoin died at Noshan, he was 59, and he bequeathed to Bowdoin College his art collection, which included European paintings, both originals and copies, and 141 Old Master drawings. So for the next 15 minutes or so, what I'd like to do is say a bit about the origin of some of these works and explore what we know about how Bowdoin acquired them. We've known for some time that a lot of evidence, virtually all of it circumstantial, indicates that a number of the drawings and several of the copies came from the estate of the Boston painter John Smybert, the owner of one of the most substantial artist studios anywhere in the colonies during the 18th century. But before we consider the evidence, let me give you a brief introduction to both Smybert and Bowdoin and where and how their interest seems to have intersected. John Smybert, whose life dates are 1688 to 1751, was a Scottish-born artist who began his career in Edinburgh, studied art in London at the Academy run by Sir Godfrey Kneller, and then traveled to Italy for 3 years between 1719 and 1722. He returned to London and remained there for 6 more years before coming to America. Comprehensive documents that record the activities of painters in the 18th century are extremely rare, and as a consequence, there was considerable excitement in the late 1960s when John Smybert's notebook, which records many of his paintings and other activities and his travels over the course of many years, was discovered in the Public Record Office in London and subsequently published in 1969. This is the title page of the book that came out, that was published by the Massachusetts Historical Society. And then on the right is one of the photographic reproductions of the actual text, which you can barely see. It's much clearer if you actually had a copy of the book here. But the goal really was to show exactly what Smybert had put together in his notebook, and then to have transcriptions of all that material done, most of which is quite accurate. There are a few inaccuracies, but they're really quite minor. Smybert's Italian trip was taken in part so that, it was the notebook of John Smybert that actually led me to study Smybert's career and then do a monograph on him in the 1990s. Smybert's Italian trip was taken in part so that he could develop contact with British travelers taking the Grand Tour, but also so he could assume the imprimatur of a more sophisticated and worldly artist. In addition, Smybert acted as an agent for an unnamed patron for whom he purchased paintings and pietra dura, hard stone boxes. Something similar to this. These were very fashionable and were produced in the ducal workshops in Florence. And Smybert also painted life portraits for traveling Englishmen, as well as copies of Old Master paintings, and some of which he records in his notebook he sold to the travelers, both the copies and the life portraits. Now, it's conceivable that the patron of Smybert's Italian sojourn, who remains unknown, was Sir Francis Grant, who had been Smybert's first significant patron in Scotland. And Sir Francis Grant was known as Lord Cullen, and he lived in a rather grand, by Scottish standards, house in Aberdeenshire called Monymusk. And so this portrait was done just before Smybert went to Italy, so it gives us a little idea of his skill level which is really hard, again, to see with these bright lights. But it was here at Monimusk many years ago that when I was working on Smibert, I spent one very cold February day in the documents room, which the Scots call monument rooms, which really document the history of their ownership of land and all of their records. And I spent about 8 hours in this rather cold space looking for any hints of Grant's relationship with John Smibert. And as it turned out, I did actually come across a couple letters which added to our what we know about Smibert, and I'll come back to them shortly. Smibert spent almost an entire year in Florence from November 1719 to November 1720, where, among other activities, he records painting two copies of Madonnas by Raphael, a copy of a Venus after Titian, as well as a copy of a head by Titian, all of which he sold. In addition, his notebook dutifully records his many financial transactions, including purchases of paintings and drawings. And if I'm not going to take time to read this, but if you look at single out one or two lines, you can see that he gives the date. And then on some lines, he records payments. He was receiving money through a Scottish banking house run by William, or member of the Aikman family. And then he records his various purchases of pictures. And the various artists that he met with to require what he was purchasing. So it was most likely during this year in Florence that Smibert painted three copies of paintings known to have been there at the time. The first is of Luigi Cornaro after Tintoretto's portrait from about 1560 to 1565. The original is in the Pitti Palace. And what Smibert is doing is just doing a reduction and painting just the head or the bust. And he did the same thing with another portrait in the Uffizi, a portrait of Jean de Montfort after Van Dyck. This is Smibert's version. And then this is the Van Dyck. And the best of Smibert's portrait copies is this portrait of Cardinal Bentivoglio after Van Dyck's full length, which was also in the Pitti Palace. Smibert's copies of Luigi Cornaro and Jean de Montfort were left to Bowdoin College as part of the bequest of James Bowdoin III, and we'll return to how they got here in just a minute. In addition, Smibert's notebook confirms that while in Florence, he bought over 250 drawings, although whether these were purchased for his patron or for himself is really subject of debate. And here in the notebook, at the bottom, there are three lines of text which indicate that he went to a painter and he purchased approximately 250 drawings, and if you convert what he actually paid for them, the total 250 drawings were the equivalent of a little less than what he would have received for a single bust portrait. So they were very modest in terms of what they cost him, and that's why some people have argued that they were so inconsequential in cost that they could have been purchased for his own use. Smibert was not a wealthy man, and so a lot of the paintings and other things that he was buying, he clearly was not buying for his own uses, but rather either at the bequest of a patron or working with some dealer in London. But it's still unclear. It's a question which we really don't have an answer to. It was while in Florence in the summer of 1720 that Smibert also met George Berkeley, an Anglo-Irish philosopher and cleric whose portrait he painted, and that survives. And it's now in a private, still actually in the hands of the family in England. Over the next few years, as they became close friends, Berkeley had an enormous influence on the artist. By 1726, Berkeley had developed a fanciful scheme to establish a city in Bermuda, or of which he created a sketch, and then published this later, this design for this idealized city of Bermuda. And the city was to include a college at which to train ministers and missionaries who would serve as an effort to prevent the expansion of Roman Catholicism in the American colonies. Berkeley really beguiled Smibert with this grand, visionary, and ultimately flawed idea, which would include an academy for painting, sculpture, and architecture, at which he hoped Smibert would become the primary teacher. Somehow, he persuaded Smibert to give up his successful practice as a portrait painter in the enormously competitive and fickle environment of London and join him as a professor of painting for this idyllic and romantic life on a tropical island. It just sounds great. It's going to sound better in January right here in Brunswick, too. Keep in mind that Smibert was a Scot, and that while many of us may find a Scottish accent quaint, often indecipherable, but nonetheless quaint, Scots were, to many Englishmen, country bumpkins and second-class citizens in England's highly stratified society. Every time Smibert spoke to an Englishman, he was reminded of this fact. So in many ways, it's not surprising that Smibert left behind his studio overlooking Covent Garden Market. And this is a painting by Joseph van Aken of Covent Garden, just at the very moment that Smibert was living there. And his studio was in the under the little piazza, it was called. It's in the back of the painting on the left. And so Smibert, for his own reasons, decided that he could depart from the congestion, the competition, and the not-so-subtle racism for the unknown of American colonies and the dream of a college in Bermuda. And I think it's important in getting a better sense of what Smibert's personality was like to listen to what people had to say about him. He was very good friends with George Vertu, the London engraver and antiquary, who wrote this about Smibert. He said that Smibert, quote, was towards honest, fair, and righteous dealing, and he could not well relish the false, selfish, griping, overreaching ways too commonly practiced here, nor was he prone to speak much in his own praise, nor any violent ways, but a decent modesty, which he thought in such a retirement as at Bermuda's, he might live quietly and for a small expense and make a great advantage by ready money, declaring he rather sought repose than profit. By 1730, when this romantic quest of living and teaching in Bermuda had finally evaporated, Smibert found himself in Boston and very quickly established himself as the portrait painter of record, which he remained so for about 20 years. His major keepsake from George Berkeley's Bermuda plan is Smibert's ambitious painting, The Bermuda Group, which became the centerpiece of his Boston studio. And in this painting, Smibert's on the far left with a drawing in his hand, and George Berkeley is on the far right, and the person who commissioned the painting is seated at the table as a scribe. During this time in Boston, Smibert also painted the town's most prominent citizens, and on a couple occasions, the citizens of New York and Philadelphia as well. For our story, it's important to note that among his sitters was James Bowdoin II as a boy, which he painted in 1736. So there was early on in the family household, the Bowdoin family household, this picture of James Bowdoin II. This portrait was retained by James Bowdoin's widow and later given to the college. So it's here now. So what exactly did a visitor see when they went to Smibert's Boston studio? Most likely, he hoped that his studio would have resembled something like the stylish of imaginary studio depicted by Peter Tillemans in 1716, with lots of paintings showing the skill or the knowledge of the painter whose studio it is, a globe, carpeted tables, you know, all sorts of things which suggested cultural activity. My guess is that Smybert's studio was far more like this image by a 17th century printmaker named Abraham Boss, and they called the drawing frame from 1637. We do know from Smybert's notebook that his Covent Garden studio was furnished with a painting window. That's what Smybert is looking through. I mean, what the artist is looking through to draw this portrait so that they can keep the proportions correct as they create the composition. His studio also had simply furnished, but had a large number of chairs, tables, and a looking glass to enhance the available light. In one of the letters I found in Scotland, Smybert described that by 1734, his father-in-law had built him a house, and two houses. The father-in-law lived in one, and Smybert and his wife lived in the other. And in his letter, he said, my father-in-law has built me a large and handsome painting room and a showroom in all respects to my satisfaction. What's not exactly clear, however, is what Smybert brought with him when he came to the colonies. We know, for example, from correspondence that the most famous copy he owned, The Countenance of Scipio, which is after a painting by Nicolas Poussin, the original from around 1640. Now, there is general agreement that this is the copy now here at Bowdoin, and that it was part of James Bowdoin III's bequest. It remained in London, however, with his good friend, the art dealer, Arthur Pond. And there's correspondence that documents that, you know, if he's going to dispose of anything and that Smybert has left with him in London, you know, please take care of the Countenance of Scipio. And he asks specifically that it be shipped to him in Boston. This is in 1743. So it really wasn't there for the first 15 years of Smybert's studio in Boston. Similarly, Smybert's copy of Cardinal Bentivoglio also remained in London. And the only thing that we're sure that was actually there early on was the Bermuda group and the preliminary sketch for the Bermuda group, which is now, it's a tiny little painting that's now at the National Gallery of Ireland. What we do know that is after Smybert died in 1751, his studio remained intact. Thanks to an estate inventory, we also know what it contained. And here's the short list, 35 portraits, many of which were probably unfinished portraits that, you know, someone commissioned and then chose not to pick up if they didn't like what it looked like. 41 history pictures and pictures in that taste, 13 landscapes. Smybert was a landscape painter as well. Two conversation pieces, most likely the Bermuda group and this little sketch for it, busts and figures in Paris plaster and models, prints and books of prints, and drawings. For the next 26 years, Smybert's studio was overseen by his nephew, John Moffat, who took great pride in showing it to visitors and renting it. But after John Moffat's death, much of the contents of the studio was sold off. And here is where the story turns to James Bowdoin III. After the young Bowdoin, Jemmy, as he was called, graduated from Harvard in 1771, he left for England. He enrolled and then abandoned the study of law at Oxford, briefly returned to Boston before setting off on the grand tour in 1773. While in Italy, he met Sir William Hamilton, British envoy to Naples and an avid collector, and that may have helped to stimulate Bowdoin's own interest in collecting. The diary of Bowdoin's traveling companion makes clear that they were awestruck by the artistic and architectural wonders they saw. And while in Italy, Bowdoin apparently had his own portrait painted at the request of the family, in part, I think, to celebrate his 21st birthday. In addition, in a letter that was cited by Susan Wegner in her essay in The Legacy of James Bowdoin III, she notes that in 1774, James Bowdoin's sister Elizabeth wrote him regarding the export of pictures. So it seems that he was already collecting by 1774, although we don't know what, as far as I know. After returning to Boston in 1775, the younger Bowdoin tried his hand at investing in shipping, which had disastrous consequences, and then privateering, again, similar results. But by 1778, one positive diversion occurred when the artist, John Trumbull, who had overlapped with Bowdoin at Harvard, rented John Smyber's studio. Their friendship blossomed, and in part stimulated by John Temple, Bowdoin's brother-in-law, who became a significant advocate for Trumbull. In addition, a relative of James Bowdoin III's by marriage, a woman otherwise unknown, a woman named Susanna Schief, was renting the other half of this double house. What had been, you know, formerly one side was Smybert's father-in-law and the other half was their house. So this was all being rented out, and it was being rented to a relative of James Bowdoin III's. And this is the very moment that the contents of Smybert's studio begin to be sold off. While John Trumbull bought 8 paintings, it appears this was the occasion, perhaps, also for James Bowdoin III to purchase the Continence of Scipio, along with the copies of the portraits of Luigi Cornaro and Jean de Montfort, as well as the 141 drawings that comprised the original bequest to Bowdoin College. At least 4 of the drawings in the bequest also give tantalizing hints of their origin. One drawing bears John Smybert's name, although not his actual signature, and I'm sure you're not going to be able to see this. You'll have to take my word for it that in the upper half of the disc in the center of this circular, this drawing, is in pencil, John. It says John Smybert's. It's clearly not in his name because thanks to the notebook, we know what his signature looks like. 2 other drawings have had his name written on the mounts. This is one, The Fall of Icarus. It was formally inscribed on the mount in ink, John Smybert. That mount is now lost. A 3rd drawing, a portraiture caricature of a man, until Sarah and I looked at this drawing again, neither one of us thought that that the inscription for this survived. We thought it also was on a mount which had been lost, but lo and behold, the inscription is there, and it says Cosimo. Let's see if I can read this. John Smybert did not write that, but it's 18th century script, and as we began to look at this more closely, it's conceivable that this could have been added to the mount by Smybert's nephew, John Moffat. So as time passes and people don't remember exactly what the story was, this may have been a way to enhance this drawing a little bit. Certainly, Smybert would have never done a caricature of Cosimo III, and more knowledgeable specialists in drawing who have looked at this have totally dismissed the idea that this is Cosimo III anyway, and the strongest suggestion is that it was probably the librarian who worked for Cosimo III and might have provided access to the collection, which all visitors wanted to see. There's one last drawing, and then I'll be done. And that's this drawing, which is quite a beautiful drawing. It's known to be by the artist Tommaso Redi, a Madonna and Child with 3 holy women, which is after Parmigianino. And the reason this drawing is so interesting, in addition to its being a beautiful drawing, is that the records in Smybert's notebook show that he actually bought a picture, P-I-C-T-O-R, from Tommaso Redi when he was in Florence. So he knew this artist personally. He bought a picture, though, not a drawing. A picture was, and the cost of it was many times what a drawing would have been. So In addition, as pointed out by David Becker's introduction to the catalog, All Master Drawings at Bowdoin College, all of the drawings in the Bowdoin bequest predate Smibert's trip to Italy. And this seems to reinforce the idea that they may all have been acquired from one source and strengthens the argument that they conceivably were all owned by John Smibert. So while there's no receipt from the executor of John Moffat's estate indicating that Bowdoin directly purchased these drawings from him, the circumstantial evidence is very convincing. And in future years, as the Bowdoin drawings are examined more thoroughly, I have no doubt that we'll get a much closer to an authoritative answer to what's really a very fascinating question. Thank you.
Caroline and I will do our teamwork again. And as Caroline prepares the slides for our third and final speaker, Sarah Cantor, it's my pleasure to have an opportunity to offer some words of introduction and welcome. Sarah Cantor completed her PhD at the University of Maryland in 2013 with a dissertation on the 17th century landscape painter Gaspard Duguay. She has held several prestigious fellowships and internships, which include a Fulbright grant to Rome, a fellowship in the Garden and Landscape Studies at Dumbarton Oaks, a curatorial fellowship at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, and an internship at the National Gallery of Art. She is the author of a forthcoming essay on the intersection between pastoral literature and landscape in the 17th century, which will appear in the volume Art and Social Change. Sarah arrived at Bowdoin in June as a Samuel H. Kress Research Fellow, helping to design and research the museum's first online scholarly catalog, and we believe the first, or certainly one of the first, such online scholarly catalogs at any academic museum. It is fittingly, we believe, dedicated to the drawings donated to the college by its founder in 1811. Sarah's research on the early history of the collection is the basis for her presentation today. Please join me in welcoming Sarah Cantor.
All right, thanks. And for the introduction, and it's been a real pleasure being here all summer and working on these drawings. So my introduction to the extraordinary collection of drawings at the Bowdoin College Museum of Art began while conducting research for my master's thesis on a group of red chalk drawings attributed to the 17th century landscape painter Gaspard Duguay. Although my study argues that the Bowdoin sheet is not actually by Duguay, but an 18th century northern artist, I was impressed by the depth and scope of the collection at this small liberal arts school in Maine. Thus, I was thrilled when offered the opportunity to conduct research on both the drawings and the history of the collection for the museum. For the past 4 months, I have been working as the Kress Research Fellow, helping to prepare the museum's first ever online scholarly catalog of the collection. The scope of the project, as Anne mentioned, is limited to the 141 Old Master drawings donated by the college's founder, James Bowdoin III, at his death in 1811. The group of drawings, comprised primarily of 16th and 17th century Italian and Dutch works, some by recognized artists and others copies after famous works, is in fact the earliest public collection of drawings in America. While many university museums and public galleries in Europe had been gifted drawings since their founding, the Bowdoin collection represents the first documented instance of Old Master works on paper. And of course, Old Master is a term that refers to mostly the eminent artists of the 16th through early 18th centuries. So this was the first to appear in a US collection. Numerous probate inventories in colonial America and the early Republic reveal the taste for prints, often copies of the Old Masters, but there are few instances of drawings listed. James Bowdoin III's collection is therefore a unique and influential example for the early Republic, representing its owner's awareness of European models and also his personal preferences in terms of subject and typology. And here I differ a bit from Richard's conclusions in that I believe a lot of the drawings were purchased by Bowdoin himself rather than bought en masse from Smybert, as I'll explain in this talk. James Bowdoin III was born into one of the wealthiest families in 18th century Boston. James Bowdoin II was a merchant, as was his father and grandfather, and an amateur scientist. In 1780, he was one of the founders of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Bowdoin II had an extensive library, which he donated to the Academy upon his death, and a moderate art collection, consisting mostly of family portraits, including the painting we just saw of him as a child by John Smybert, several originals or copies of old masters, and a number of prints. Educated at Harvard like his father, Bowdoin III left for England in December 1770 before officially receiving his diploma due to his ill health. He enrolled at Oxford, intending to study law, but transferred to the King's Riding School, where he learned French, dancing, and fencing. At both Oxford and in London, Bowdoin would have encountered collections of old master paintings, drawings, and prints. Although letters from his father complain of his rate of spending money and seeming lack of focus on his studies, no art purchases were mentioned. However, it's likely that the exposure to the university collections at Oxford and the newly opened British Museum, both combining art with science and antiquities, like the private cabinets of curiosity or Wunderkammers of the previous centuries, sparked Bowdoin's interest in collecting and the rational ordering of the world. And here we have a painting of an imaginary Wunderkammer from the 17th century and a print showing the Ashmolean Museum at Oxford in the early 19th century, where we can see some paintings on the wall behind the lecturer. Bowdoin would have also attended exhibitions and sales in London, learning of the importance of drawing to the history of art. From the late 16th century onward, collectors believed that drawings allowed for a better understanding of the genius and skill of the artist, more so than painting, that one can actually see an artist's thoughts more on paper than in the final finished product. Bowdoin returned to Boston in April of 1772, and the next year set sail again for Europe. In October of 1773, he left for Italy with a travel companion, Ward Nicholas Boylston, who was actually born Ward Hallowell. He changed his name in 1770 at the promise of receiving an inheritance from his uncle, Nicholas Boylston. So this is the fabulous Copley portrait of his uncle, Nicholas Boylston, on the left. It's now with the fog, and a much later portrait of Ward Nicholas Boylston on the right. They arrived in Naples in mid-January, remaining in the city, then under the control of Spain and ruled by Ferdinand IV, who was later deposed by Napoleon, for over a month. Boylston kept a comprehensive diary, recording his and Bowdoin's visits to Mount Vesuvius, Pompeii, Herculaneum, various churches, and major art collections, as well as when they dined with important individuals, such as Sir William Hamilton, who was the British ambassador to the Kingdom of Naples and an influential collector of antiquities, as Richard mentioned. Hamilton's substantial collection of ancient vases, sold to the British Museum in 1772, greatly added to their holdings of Greek and Roman works. Prior to the sale, the entire collection was published in four lavishly illustrated volumes by Pierre-François de Ingorville, an amateur dealer and scholar, with contributions by Johann Winckelmann, the German art historian and archaeologist. It is likely that at the many dinners and gatherings Bowdoin attended at the Hamilton residence, he was introduced to the writings and scholarship of Winckelmann, whose treatise on the history of ancient art is recognized as one of the foundational texts for the discipline of art history. The volume, translated from the original German into French in 1794, was purchased by Bowdoin and later donated, along with the rest of his library, to the college. So he had the entire works of Winckelmann that are still, the original volumes, are still in special collections here at Bowdoin. Although Boylston recounts in detail the paintings, sculptures, and antiquities that he and Bowdoin saw during their stay, he doesn't mention any art purchases. Bowdoin, however, in a letter to his sister, Elizabeth Temple, dated January 21st, does state that he will have his portrait taken at her request, which, as Richard mentioned, is the work now at the museum where we don't know who the artist is. On March 12th, the travelers arrived in Rome, where Bowdoin asked that his letters be directed to the art dealer and travel guide, James Byers, who escorted a number of British and American travelers on the Grand Tour and sold numerous works to his clients. Boylston again provides detailed accounts of their visits to ancient monuments and churches. Whereas there was little discussion of particular artists in the entries for Naples, for Rome, Boylston carefully notes the famous paintings and frescoes that decorate each and every church. And there's a very extended entry on all of the chapels in St. Peter's. Boylston also begins to discuss different types of marble that he and Bowdoin encounter at sites, whether ancient or modern. In the 1790s, Harvard received from both travelers the gift of marble tile samples, almost certainly purchased during this period in Rome. Bowdoin continued to collect geological specimens and related materials throughout his life, donating the majority to Bowdoin College. For both Boylston and Bowdoin, the Grand Tour provided an opportunity to study the ancient past, the great art produced in Italy, and purchase reminders of their voyage. The two companions parted in Rome. Bowdoin continued to Florence, then Bologna and France, and then heading to England to stay with his sister and her husband until his father insisted upon his return, which finally happened in September 1775. Despite the lack of documentation of definitive purchases of art during the Italy trip, Bowdoin certainly bought some paintings and likely drawings, which he left in England with his sister. And there's in the collection here is a 1754 painting. It's signed and dated by a French artist who was working in Rome and had a studio there in the 1770s. So Elizabeth Temple wrote to Bowdoin in March of 1784, complaining of the exorbitant cost of shipping works back to Boston and suggesting instead that Mr. Christie, the founder of Christie's, sell them at auction. Much later in life, after having been appointed minister to Spain, Bowdoin composed a letter to the president, Thomas Jefferson, thanking him for the offer of a diplomatic position and offering his services as a connoisseur of fine art, should the need arise. In the letter, after stating that, quote, having been in Italy and having viewed the works of the best masters, if you would entrust me with your commissions, I would execute them in the best manner of my power, end quote. He then offers a gift to Jefferson of a small marble sculpture, a copy of the ancient Roman Ariadne, then in the Louvre, but previously in the Vatican collection, and of course later returned there after Napoleon. So the original is at the top, and the small sculpture, about so big, is still at Monticello. Bowdoin notes that his work was originally owned by a Frenchman, but executed from the original in Rome. As this letter was sent before Bowdoin actually left for Europe on the mission, the sculpture was very likely a purchase that he made on previous trips, so likely during the Grand Tour picked up in Rome. There thus exists some evidence for Bowdoin's collecting activities, but no mention of these 141 drawings. In the earliest catalogs of the collection, dating from the late 19th century, the assumption was that all paintings and drawings were purchased during Bowdoin's diplomatic mission, during which he spent the 2 years in Paris attempting to negotiate with the French who controlled Spain. Although his mission was a failure, he returned with a number of the latest French furnishings and decor, making his home in Boston one of the most fashionable in the city, and several contemporary paintings. It is also likely that Bowdoin bought drawings during the trip, as several of the works are of French origin and dating from the mid to late 18th century. So although previously the works had all been attributed to the early 18th century or before, I am arguing in my study and in the catalog that some of these works, particularly these two we see on the screen, are actually from the later 18th century and therefore could not have been purchased by Smibert, who died in 1751. So we have a beautiful example of a Rococo drawing, sort of in the style of Fragonard, at the left, and then at the right, a more neoclassical drawing, so slightly later. Bowdoin's wife, Sarah, kept a diary during their time in France, recording visits to palaces and art collections, including visits to exhibitions of contemporary work. So they were certainly going to see art, we just don't have her documenting what they are buying. At least several of Bowdoin's drawings came from a very different source, as we just heard in Richard's talk, the studio of John Smybert, who had settled in Boston in 1729. So as Richard mentioned, Smybert lists this group of 250 drawings that he purchased from Signore Scacciari, a flower painter in Florence in 1720. This artist has been identified as a member of the Scacciati family of flower painters and printmakers who were active in Florence in the later 17th and 18th centuries. So Smybert had opened a home in his shop in, opened a shop in his home and studio in Boston, where he was selling not only showing off his paintings, but selling colors, oils, materials for painting fans, mezzotints, and prints, but not drawings. So we have multiple advertisements from Smybert, but he is never offering his services as a collector and dealer of drawings. But, as we saw earlier, again, he does depict himself in the Bermuda group painting at left holding a drawing. So he's likely in this painting demonstrating his view of the importance of drawing as an intellectual rather than a manual activity. And as other scholars have noted, he's paired himself with the commissioner of the portrait who's writing, so this connection between the intellectual activity of writing and the intellectual activity of drawing. So Smybert's studio not only trained young artists, but was accessible to other artists who could admire the collection of copies of old masters and plaster casts. His nephew inherited the estate after the early death of his two sons, and the contents were sold after 1778. James Bowdoin, of course, just a few years returned from the grand tour and friendly with John Trumbull, who rented the studio, likely jumped at the opportunity to purchase works, most notably, again, the copy of the Continents of Scipio by Smybert, and these three drawings that bear the inscription somewhere, either on the Mount Lost, to Smybert that indicate their provenance. So we have a late 16th century drawing of the fall of Icarus at left, this late 16th century German or Dutch design for a circular plate at center, and then this caricature of that was believed to be Duke Cosimo III that the inscription we saw claims to be Smybert himself. To this, we can also add that lovely Tommaso Redi drawing, from whom Smybert purchased a painting. As the drawings in Smybert's inventory at his death were recorded only as a group, and no other works bear inscriptions or notations connecting them to Smybert, it's impossible to determine just how many of the 141 were certainly from the artist, and how many were purchased by Bowdoin on European trips. I believe that evidence from the drawings themselves helps sort out this mystery, at least a bit. Although mentioned by David Becker briefly in his 1985 catalog of the entire collection of drawings at Bowdoin College, the original mounts were dismissed as not providing any substantial evidence of past ownership. The mounts, or papers on which the drawings were glued down and then kept in folios, around 40 of which were preserved after a major conservation campaign in the early 1980s, are all laid paper, meaning that they date from earlier than the 19th century, and a number display these decorative framing lines with inscribed attributions below in an elegant script. And so you can see on the right is a conservation photo that was taken when the drawings were conserved, so before the one on the right was removed from its mount, so we can see what they look like originally, and then on the left is one of the mounts today. The idea of mounting drawings and including elaborate framework around each dates to the 16th century with the artist Giorgio Vasari. Vasari, in parallel with the biographies he wrote on the lives of Italian artists, kept an extensive collection of drawings, which he mounted and bound in folios called the Libro dei Disegni. Later collectors, mostly nobility and merchants rather than artists, used the Libro as a model for their own collections, which could serve as books on the history and development of art. And here's an example from the 18th century from the French scholar and collector Pierre-Jean Mariette. Collectors and their visitors could flip through pages of beautifully framed old master drawings, admiring the skill of the artist's hand, the progression of the arts, and the collector's taste and judgment. Based on the spellings in several inscriptions on the Bowdoin sheets, the writer is almost certainly an English speaker, I think it's almost impossible to see in the image, but on the bottom right corner of this mount, in the same hand, it's written in graphite, died 1530, so not morte or any other language, it's certainly somebody who is an English speaker. Stylistically, these frame sheets resemble the mounting system. Oh, and this is, the drawing that the mount was originally, attached to the mount. So the frame sheets resemble the mounting system employed by the early 18th century British artist, theorist, and collector, Jonathan Richardson Sr. So you see on the right, one of Jonathan Richardson's drawings that's currently in the Victoria and Albert Museum. So you can see the pattern of the lines is very similar, this very thick outline, and then this broad band of watercolor, and then smaller lines, and all of Richardson's drawings have this gold leaf around the edges of the drawings that's been painted in, but that doesn't exist in any of the Bowdoin sheets. Both Bowdoin and Smybert could have seen Richardson's drawings, which were sold at auctions and sales in London during his lifetime and after his death in 1745. Additionally, watermarks on these mounts indicate that all of the, watermarks on these mounts, both those that include framing lines and others with simple inscriptions or no markings at all, indicate that the works were mounted at the same time. Most of the marks appear to be of English or Dutch origin, meaning that the paper was not made in the US. So we have here one example, this watermark that's called the Maid of Dort with the Pro Patria sign, and this is often used on Dutch and English papers in the 18th century. It is possible that Smybert took the time to carefully mount his collection of drawings for storage in folios, possibly while preparing for his move to Bermuda to serve as the art instructor at Barclays Academy. But that would really make him unique among artists in the 18th century. Although, of course, artists did collect drawings, the majority were intended for studio use to be copied and studied by students. It's usually only wealthy collectors who employ elaborate frames. It's entirely possible, and I would actually argue likely, that Bowdoin himself directed the mounting of the drawings based on the collections he saw during his multiple stays in London. Looking at the breakdown of subjects and types of drawings would indicate that this collection might not have been purchased en masse as well, but carefully selected by the owner from various sales. For example, there are at least 10 counterproofs in the group of 141. An extraordinarily large number compared to other collections. And in the 1985 catalog of the entire collection, there's only two other counterproofs. The counterproof, or offset, is taken by wetting a blank sheet of paper and pressing it against the original drawing, usually in chalk. The reverse image then prints onto the new sheet. Hence, the Christ child is blessing with his left hand in the Masucci drawing, at the bottom rather than with his right. From the appearance of so many of these works in the collection, it seems that Bowdoin may have favored counterproofs. Beyond the number of counterproofs, however, there appears to be some interest in particular subjects. The breakdown of the entire collection is as follows: around 65 biblical scenes, of which more than half are images of the Holy Family, the Virgin and Child, or the visitation, the meeting between the Virgin Mary and her cousin Elizabeth when they both are pregnant. The subject was likely a particularly poignant one for Bowdoin, who died childless. The next largest group is landscape, and then classical mythology, equaling about 25 each. And of course, the landscape drawing on the left is the most famous in the entire collection, this beautiful alpine landscape, which was previously attributed to Peter Bruegel the Elder, but is now assigned to the master of the mountain landscapes, meaning that drawing scholars have not been able to particularly decipher who he might be. So during the course of his life, Bowdoin likely kept his collection of drawings in his library. They were cataloged there in 1811 by John Abbott, sent from the college to document the property it inherited upon Bowdoin's death. The entire library, comprising over 2,000 volumes, arrived with the two folios of drawings in 1811 and the paintings in 1813. Bowdoin intended that his art and science collections, along with the library, would serve as models of instruction for generations of students. The drawings continued to reside in their original folios in the library until the opening of the Walker Art Building in 1894, where all were displayed with the paintings. So there were actually racks, little rails installed in the galleries, and all of the drawings were framed and placed on the rails, and apparently one could actually pick up a drawing to examine it more closely if one was so inclined. Unfortunately, having them exposed for such a long period of time means that a number of the drawings are faded today. According to more recent catalogs and studies, the drawings were all but forgotten in the library, gathering dust and unnoticed by students and professors alike, until 1881, when a student rediscovered them and composed a comprehensive catalog based primarily on the inscriptions on the drawings themselves and the mount attributions. The drawings, however, were not forgotten. They're mentioned in library catalogs throughout the 19th century and were published in an article in the Art Journal entitled The Art Treasures of Bowdoin College, where a number were described as powerfully drawn and graceful. Students throughout the early 19th century could have consulted the folios, flipping through pages of drawings and their elaborate mounts with attributions carefully noted, reading the history of art, and appreciating Bowdoin's taste as a collector. Thank you.
I want to start by thanking each of our panelists for an extraordinary set of presentations. They were a pleasure to listen to and extraordinarily interesting to hear together. So I just want to say thank you.
Terrific.
This is an audience that I know already has a great deal of familiarity with Bowdoin's collections. It's fun to be part of an event where we have so many knowledgeable people who I know are very eager to engage our speakers. I certainly have questions of my own, but I think I will start by opening the floor right away to the audience and to ask whether there are any questions for our speakers.
Yes, hello, thank you for a wonderful afternoon. A lot of thought-provoking ideas and introducing, to me anyway, the works of James Bowdoin and his interesting taste. My question has to do with the aesthetics of portraiture and, you know, with sort of the idealism of the Greeks, especially the bust on the one side and, say, Van Gogh or Picasso on the other side. Where was the aesthetic taste of portraits, both by the person commissioning it and by the sitter and by the painter? Who had the say in how the person was portrayed in that time.
Okay. What I've seen, certainly of Stuart and other painters of his contemporaries, that artists had a lot to say about how the person was represented. And in fact, that's why people went to a certain artist. And that's why Stuart was so fascinating. People described how he painted a portrait. And he would say to the person, go ahead and walk around, behave the way you want to, do what you want. And then eventually, he would sort of distill a sense of their character. The whole point, I think, was not just to represent them at the time, but to draw from that behavior or that person an overall sense of them as a character, a personality. So there's an abstraction that's taking place, but there is a likeness that's involved in the process. Now, I remember an 18th century portrait by John Wollaston, where the young man was painted in America, sent it back to his family in England, and wrote, this is meant to be me, but the shoulders are not as broad as my shoulders. So there was a lot of, not complaining, but observation that the accuracy wasn't the primary goal. The main goal was to really give a visual biography, I would say. I don't know. Rick, you
add? Yeah, I think there are a lot of factors involved. Ellen and I have written about kind of consistency, the stylistic consistencies in Anglo-American portraiture that predominate, and that there are certain guidelines and rules that are followed in terms of poses, in terms of formats, in terms of backgrounds, and that the details that there are a number of cases where, just as Ellen said, people would write and say, I'm sending you my portrait, but the suit that I'm in is not, you know, it doesn't reflect, it's not my own suit, or, you know, I mean, so they would be very concerned about little details. The other thing that I think is important to keep in mind is that there was this idealizing spirit, so it was a fine line for the artist to capture a likeness, something that people could identify as being of that person, but also being careful to Photoshop as needed, and there are a lot of wonderful comments.
And I think that's why you never see people grinning, because that's a kind of the moment sense, you know, laughing like that caricature. That's why caricature is caricature, because it's of the moment, whereas portraiture is more of a permanent kind of quality.
Yeah, there's some wonderful quotes about, you know, there's nothing so. In the 19th century, really, about someone looking so foolish as to be smiling or having their mouth open. And the poses also conveyed things as well, and the motifs that were used. I mean, the Nicholas Boylston portrait that mm-hmm. is a very unusual portrait, where he's in a dressing gown, he's taken his wig off, he's wearing his banyan.
Brandon Fortune did a whole catalog discussing those informal portraits as intellectual portraits. Mm-hmm. So it's not, it's a kind of apparatus or a presentation of the person still being an intellectual achiever, you might say. But what this reminds me of is that I found also in late 18th and early 19th century American portraits, the people who cared the most about accurate representation were people in uniform. And they wanted that to be accurate because that was something that they had achieved, that rank and that service. And their complaints by sitters to ask Charles Wilson Peel to repaint the portraits by Robert Edge Pine, because Pine didn't really pay attention to those kind of details. And the sitters wanted it to be correct. So I always find that fascination of an exchange between the sitter and the artist.
Yeah, so I guess the answer is, unlike today, where a wealthy sitter, I think the relationship between the artist and the sitter has changed considerably over time. Whereas now we, you know, tend to remember the sitter more than the artist in some cases. I mean, at least in formal portraiture. Whereas, you know, early on, I mean, the records we have were frequently talking about, the artist may be known, but the sitter is no longer known.
I'm curious as to the curricular or extracurricular use of the collection at Bowdoin. Why would Bowdoin need a collection in the early 19th century?
It's a good question. Well, most art museums really didn't exist as a form until to the 19th century. But like the cabinets of curiosities that started in the 16th century and throughout 17th and 18th, art played a role in that. And so we know when what happened with the paintings after their arrival is they were displayed in Massachusetts Hall, the earliest building at Bowdoin, and in what would have been the classroom. So they're basically serving as a backdrop to the lesson plans. And I don't know, certainly not intended as art historical lessons. You wouldn't lecture about the development of art, but they certainly seem to be used for moral lessons. I mean, particularly the continence of Scipio, which was a very popular subject in 18th century America and in 19th century America as this Republican moral ideal, proper behavior. And amusingly, some of the paintings were actually sold from the collection because they did not hold proper moral standards. There were copies of Titian nude women, Callisto and Danae, that were sold off in the 1850s because they would not instill proper moral thoughts in young men attending Bowdoin College. As for the drawings, we really don't know for sure if of evidence, their use really in the 19th century. But the first catalog was written by a Bowdoin student who spent the time describing the drawings in detail and recording attributions and in some cases trying to make attribution guesses of his own. So understanding the history of art. And there were other art books in Bowdoin's collection that arrived with his library. So it wasn't just Winckelmann, but there was actually a portfolio of prints of Trajan's column that were done in the 17th century as a collaboration between the theorist Giovanni Bellori and the artist Pietro Santi Bartoli. So you had this entire images of all of Trajan's column that would have been available for students to peruse and to understand Roman history.
Also, we hadn't mentioned that when Stuart came here in 1821, he looked at some of the paintings, mm-hmm. didn't he, and drawings. So mm-hmm. there was obviously somebody interested in that collection as early as 1821, yeah.
Yeah, there's certainly mentions throughout the 19th century of these art treasures of Bowdoin College as they were described in this 1880 article.
Mm-hmm. I might just chime in for a moment as well. And in my introductory remarks, I noted that I think it's extraordinary what kinship seems to exist intellectually between James Bowdoin III and the present generation. I find it extremely exciting that when the Walker sisters built the Art Museum, which was 1894, it ended up being placed in a very prominent position on the campus. The art collection, as Sarah notes, had previously been at Massachusetts Hall. It had previously been in the chapel. So it actually has literally always occupied a central place in the education here at Bowdoin. That certainly continues to be the case today. A parallel that I find quite fascinating back in the 19th century is a parallel that I certainly haven't explored, maybe others have, but I think could be interesting to dig into, between James Bowdoin III and James Smithson, who was gave the money that led to the foundation of the Smithsonian collection in Washington. He was British, Bowdoin was educated here, but at any rate, I think the idea that there is something useful to be learned from a collection of objects is extremely significant, as is, I think, the transatlantic quality of the collection, the fact that this is a way, in a sense, of importing the culture from the old world into the new. But it's a fabulous question, as you can see from the fact that we're all intrigued by it.
Oh, yeah, just to follow up on that, so the paintings were in Massachusetts Hall until the chapel was built, the new chapel was built in the 1850s, and a space on the second floor was designated as the gallery for the display of paintings, and they actually had students acting as curators for the collection, and they were expected to give tours to be able to present on these works.
Like that? Okay. Thank you so much. That's been very interesting. I enjoyed it a lot. Thank you. I have two questions, one for Richard and the other one for Sarah. So for Richard, it seems to me like you were suggesting that a Smybert might be dealing with the copies that he was painting, because that seems to me to be the case for many artists that went to Italy. And since they didn't have money and he spent there 3 years, he probably was trying to make money through making copies because there was that big market. And it may also explain the reason why he's cutting out like the full-length portraits into just the face. That seems to me like possible. I don't know about that. It's also interesting that he was making copies of Van Dyck, because at that time I would rather go for copies of Carracci, Raphael, or this kind of Italian. There might be a broader market among British peers and gentlemen that were on the grand tour. So that might be one reason why he kept the Bentivoglio. Maybe he couldn't find a buyer for that. That's just speculating and just thinking if you have come across any of these evidences.
I think he sold pictures like copies of after Raphael. And so I absolutely agree. I think he was trying to make money. That's why I think, the question of him acquiring a lot of things for his own purposes, I think were very selective. He had limited resources. And when you document the way he lived when he came back to London and the amount of income that he got compared to some other painters, initially he struggled, I think, as a Scottish artist living in London. And a number of his clients were Scots who were living in London and sought him out. I don't find the reductions, I think, might have been a practical matter of, canvas was expensive. To be able to ship a 30 by 25 inch canvas or move it back to England, I think it might have had something to do with that. We don't really know if he did copies that he then sold to unknown patrons that were of a larger scale. The only large picture we have I believe is the Continents of Scipio is a copy by Smybert, but it wasn't done on his Italian trip. I believe it was painted in London as he was planning to go to Bermuda, and also when he was patronized by Robert Walpole, who owned the picture. So I think that's a very different picture, and I've said a little bit about why it's confusing it, because it's to some people it's considered to be, no, it couldn't possibly be by Smybert because it's too good to be by Smybert. But to those people, I would ask the question, which Smyberts did you look at when you were drawing that determination? And Smybert was really at the peak of his career in the late 1720s, and just as he arrived in the colonies. And then his work goes downhill rather rapidly. The Bowdoin picture that's here is actually one of his very best American pictures, and that's about where you want to stop taking too many of his portraits too seriously. But in any event, I think you make a very good point. But I think Titian and Van Dyck were important because he could keep those with him and show that he had looked and had copied some of the great portrait figures. So, and if you read, the guidebooks, who they're writing about and they're citing, he certainly is following some of the well-established practices of who to single out to paint.
And so now for Sarah, I think that you were trying to suggest that Bowdoin was kind of discerning patron or more mm-hmm. discerning patron than what we thought. Mm-hmm. And so that may explain the collection of drawings. And I was also wondering, coming back again with that idea about what was the purpose of drawings in a collection in the 19th century, I would like to ask you, have you come across with any evidence? when Bowdoin gifted the collection of drawings, did he refer to them or did he make any mention about what was the purpose for that or what was his idea about that? Or what could that be of help for teaching? And I was also wondering, I mean, like, to support your idea that he was a discerning patron, if you have the library that he actually used, the actually that belonged to him, if you could go through his collection, I mean, like, Winckelmann was something like anybody should have. Mm-hmm. And if you go to Italy, you have to buy a Winckelmann. But if you have come across to other books and paintings that may support your argument about that.
So in answer to the first part, did he actually describe what he thought should happen to the art collection upon its arrival at the college? And the answer is no. There's really very little writing from him about art in general. So we have very few references except to purchases made while in Paris. And of course, this comment from his letter to Thomas Jefferson, where he describes himself as a connoisseur of fine art. I'm trying to remember the second part now. The library. Yes, sorry. I knew that was an easy answer. We do have the entire library because John Abbott arrived at the Boston home in 1811 and inventoried every single book that was to come to Bowdoin College, and those are still here in special collections, and the inventory is here in special collections as well. And it's hopefully currently being digitized, so it will be available, and we're going to link to it through the online catalog. And it includes the list of these two folios of drawings, and it includes a full catalog of the 70-some paintings that were to arrive as well slightly later.
Great. I see two more questions, and we'll take those, but we'll, I guess, ask everybody to be slightly restrained. We're closing in on 6:15, so I just want to be sensitive to the time, but George, we'd love to hear your thoughts, and then Susan, we'll hear from you as our concluding voice. Yes, I think so.
I just have a couple of observations to make, and they're probably primarily oriented to Ellen, which concerns the series of presidential portraits. I think that Gilbert Stuart seems to have got himself tied up in knots in a funny way, because some of the images don't have hands, and some of them do. If I remember correctly, the Gibbs series doesn't depict the hands. And so when he's doing these versions, I think it explains why the John Adams is in reverse, because he's gesturing with his right hand with the print, whereas if he was represented the other way, he would be gesturing with his left hand. The second thing is this wonderful comment that John Fitzgerald Kennedy made when he was hosting a dinner at the White House with all of the Nobel Prize winners from the United States, saying that he thought probably this room had never experienced such a degree of genius except when Thomas Jefferson was dining alone. And that may explain why Franklin was appearing in that image, because he, of course, was a great inventor as well.
Huh. That's a good idea. So the Gibbs series is interesting to me because I think that Gibbs owned the smaller portrait, and that's an identical version of the life portrait of Monroe that was commissioned and belonged to, I think, to Monroe. But Gibbs's father-in-law, Oliver Wolcott, was an admirer of Monroe and asked for that copy. So Gibbs starts his idea of a series, if that's where it comes from, with the painting of Monroe. So it's already got the format of the head and shoulders without the hands. So then, you know, he goes on and the other four are in the same scale. And in fact, Jefferson, when he was finally given the one that he was given, they asked him, Dearborn asked him, what size do you want it to be? Or Stuart asked. And he said, I would like it to be this size because that's the same size as the other portraits I have of other people. So often what you need to do is look at the series in order to understand the individual picture and why it's the size that it is. But in terms of Franklin, I think my intrigue really is with Benjamin Vaughan and the Vaughan family. And I want, Benjamin Vaughan was a radical politician in England and actually had published Franklin's autobiography. He told Franklin in 1879, I think, you should publish this because somebody else will write your biography if you don't write it. So the Vaughans were already admirers and knew Franklin personally. And then they owned the bust of Franklin. So I can't help thinking that somewhere in the conversation, this is why the portrait is introduced, only we don't know. I guess my main point is we only can speculate. Yeah.
I'll be very brief. Thank you for wonderful presentations, very thought-provoking, and will certainly cause many more conversations and questions and arguments. Almost all of you, I think, commented on the activities of the Bowdoin women, either instigating commissions or complaining about expenses of shipping. And Sarah, you mentioned Sarah Bowdoin's diary, where she does talk about going to art exhibitions. And I'm wondering whether there might be a place for Sarah's contribution in the creation of the collection. So I just leave that out there. You don't have to answer it, but just consider it. Thank you.
Yeah, I think it's a very good question, especially as I brought up these sort of the breakdown of subjects. I mean, the visitation is a fairly common subject in 16th and 17th century painting, but there are 8 different drawings of this in a group of only 141. So to me, that's just implies that perhaps if whoever collected these, Bowdoin, Smybert, came across a drawing of the visitation that he particularly decided to purchase it. And it would make sense for Sarah and James Bowdoin, who of course were childless, despite the fact that there's comments from James Bowdoin II always mentioning the hopes of an heir to come, which would never happen. So there's also a number of studies of just women and children. There's actually 3 different drawings, one of which is a copy after a small section of a Tintoretto painting that is just a mother and child. And there's a drawing by Bernardino Bocchetti that's a study for a mother and child, and then another that's attributed to Lorenzo Gambara, which will likely change in the catalog, that's also a mother and child. None of these are the Virgin and child, they're just figures. So there seems to be sort of an interest in this relationship between mothers and children, and interest in children in particular in this group of drawings that, to me, looking through large collections, that you don't necessarily see quite as much of that. So it's sort of interesting that perhaps Sarah Bowdoin did have some sort of an interest in and may have directed collecting while they were in Paris, because she was certainly going to various shops, dealers, and we know for sure purchasing furnishings, wallpapers, silks. But again, there's still no mention of buying drawings.
Well, I think we'll leave it on that note. And as Susan rightly observed, I know that there will be lots of subsequent food for thought, lots of conversations to grow out of today's panel. And again, thank you, Ellen, Rick, and Sarah, for a terrific discussion.